Episode 20, Rope's End. At the base of the aviary, Hoskins, his team, and Tim look down on Sarah performing CPR on the man that Dennis had just pulled from the river. Suddenly the man starts to cough and throw up water. Sarah helps him onto his side to spew the water out. On his side, with his eyes closed, facing down to the ground, the man leans weakly on his left arm. Then Billy Brennan talks.
Thanks, Amanda.
He coughs a few more times, still not fully aware of his surroundings. Who's Amanda? Not recognizing the voice, Billy turns to look around and sees the five guards, Tim, Sarah, and Hoskins, standing there looking at him.
Who are you?
Trying to move, he drops through his arm and rolls back onto his back, looking up at Hoskins. Hurt, Billy groans.
The question is, who are you? Get him inside of the car. He can explain back at the village. I'll call it in.
Hoskins takes his walkie-talkie, presses the button to speak, and remembers he turned it off. He switches the device on, and it starts crackling. Presses the send button.
Engine control, this is a retrieval team. We've encountered the visitors and picked one of them up at the aviary. We lost the others, over.
Vic? Christ, finally! You need to come back in. We'll be evacuated in about an hour. Do you read? Come back in, over?
Can't come back in, we haven't found the other visitors yet. What do you mean, evac? Over.
Long story, just get back here. Over and out.
Damn. Alright, here's what we do. You guys all go back with that guy in the transport compartment.
Then he turns to Billy.
You. How many more of you are out there?
I think he needs some rest.
I need to know. Hey, you.
I, three, and a kid.
Kid! Christ. Okay, that'll fit.
Hoskins throws the hat he pulled earlier out of the river onto Billy.
You keep that. I'll continue with the other car and get the others. You go back.
All okay, right,
correcting
sir.
Sarah, Hoskins turns at her.
I wasn't talking to you. You just make sure he'll be able to explain himself when I get back.
And he walks past them, back into the tunnel, to get into the car without a transport compartment. The one back in the tunnel, and drives the car in reverse back up the tunnel.
Let's get him in the car and go back to the village.
Gently, the guards pick up the groaning Billy Brennan and put him in the back of the car in the transport compartment. Sarah and Tim get in there with him, and guard Dennis joins them too. Laura gets in the driver's seat and Bob calls shotgun. Sydney and Andy got in the back seats of the car. Trying to support Billy, Sarah sighs. Then to the driver she calls out.
Drive carefully, okay?
In the control tower at the worker village, Jerry Harding was discussing the situation with the commander, with the three control workers looking at them, and keeping an eye on a clock. Time was starting to run short.
There are people out on the island, and Henry has found a cure. We can't let them evacuate us now.
Don't you think I tried? What do you want me to do?
Whenever that Navy captain calls in again, just tell him.
Sir, they're hailing us.
And the controller puts the call on speaker.
Engine control, this is the captain of the USS Carl Vinson. The helicopters will land on your location in 20 minutes. Have your men ready to be picked up. Confirm. Over.
Jerry Harding walked over to the control worker station and picked up a horn for communication. He pressed the send button.
Captain, this is Dr. Harding. Not all our men are in yet. Over.
They have 20 minutes. Over.
You're just going to blow them up? We have the cure. If you blow us up, you'll blow that up with us. Abort your mission. Over.
A short moment of silence.
Nice try. If you have the cure, be sure to bring it with you. We have our orders, and we will not be delayed. Get ready. Over and out.
Bloody hell.
In frustration, he slams the horn back down. Twice. The retrieval team was already out of the jungle, on their way back, driving over a jungle road, their engine Humvee bumping along. Tim, Sarah and guard Dennis were trying to support Billy Brennan from hitting the floor too hard with each bump in the transport compartment. Leaves of trees lashed against the side of the car, clouds were coming in and the skies were turning dark. Billy was groaning as the car bumps over another pothole or a rock on the road, with Sarah unsuccessfully supporting him. She leaned back to the front to call out to the driver.
Can you slow it down? We have an injured man back here.
Guard Sydney and Andy both look back from the back seats through the center window. Without looking back, the driver responds.
You heard control. We should be there for evac, but that guy gets there ASAP so he can be treated properly.
Drops start to fall on the windshield as it starts to rain.
Great.
Laura flicks on the windshield wipers. Vision quickly becoming less through the darkening world, jungle and rain. As rain starts to come down harder, they hardly notice the ground started trembling, and suddenly the car is hit by something. Lifting up the right side of the car, by the impact, throwing Sarah, Tim, Dennis and Billy against the left side.
What?
Billy groans loudly, and the car drives on, slamming back on the ground.
What was that?
Through the back opening of the transport compartment, Sarah sees an animal lying on its side, trying to get up after the hit. As they take distance, two more animals appear from the jungle line, turning to run along with the car.
We've been hit by a gallimimus.
Looks like it, okay.
Through the rain, they leave the jungle onto a field. Around their car, about 20 gallimimus are now running along with them. From the back seats, cars Sydney and Andy are both looking out the window, smiling.
This is great! They should have this on the tour!
Amazing!
Laura looks very serious. Driving among these animals takes all her concentrations not to hit any of them. From the transport compartment, they can't look to the sides, but they can see some of the gallimimus a little ahead of the car through the small opening on the front, and some of the animals behind them through the waving pieces of cloth flapping at the back of the car. The animals look dark and glistening wet from the rain.
Wow!
Tim holds on tight with one hand to the side of the compartment and grips his gun with the other. Sarah, seeing him taking his gun, responds surprised.
What is it, Tim? They're harmless.
Birds, flocking. No clue what Tim just said. Comment. She turns her attention back to Billy, who groans again as the car bumps on the field.
Easy, you're doing okay.
Halfway through the field, the gallimimus group suddenly takes a turn to the left and flocks around the car, away from their path.
Hey, where'd it go?
Oh god!
In a short moment, when her headlights driving beam had shown ahead at the jungle line, Laura spotted the dark shapes waiting there and she slammed the brakes. Everyone was thrown forward in the car.
Arm yourselves!
Sliding through the dark grass, the car leaving deep muddy tracks, slides to a halt on the field in the heavy rain. Huskins arrived at the top of a cliff and was now listening to the sounds of the Spinosaurus, which must be down below in the river. He stopped near the edge. His headlights shone down onto the river, and he noticed the Spinosaurus who once again found their visitors, who were so preoccupied with the Spinosaurus that was attacking them, that they didn't notice his lights shining down. Huskins looked down, and he was almost sure that he would be able to turn back to the village with the sad news that none of the others had made it. He looked amazed at one of those guys climbing on top of a crane, and another firing a flare, lighting up the petrol from the sunken boat around the Spinosaurus, which then walked off. It wasn't time to go back yet. He had to get down there.